Welcome to this class on Neuroscience of Human Movement. In this class, we will continue our discussion on basal ganglia. This time, we will be discussing about the various functions of the basal ganglia. So, in today's class, we will be discussing motor functions of the basal ganglia, the associative or executive decision making related functions of basal ganglia, and the limbic functions of the basal ganglia. Note that basal ganglia is traditionally considered as a motor nuclei or motor nucleus of the brain. So, in other words, for a long time it was believed that basal ganglia is essentially a motor organ or related to motor function. This is because basal ganglia dysfunction essentially caused several motor problems that were readily observable. So, in general, motor functions and motor areas of basal ganglia are relatively well studied, whereas other functions and other areas of the basal ganglia are relatively poorly studied. Even now, the cognitive functions of the basal ganglia, the associative and executive functions of the basal ganglia, and also the emotional role of basal ganglia, although are very important, somehow are studied lesser than the motor aspects. Note also, it is easier to test hypothesis regarding motor function, and in general it is because why is that so? Note, it is also easier to formulate and test hypothesis regarding motor functions when compared with other aspects of basal ganglia function. Why would one say this? Because in general, the movements are observable, right? So, basically motor aspects or motor functions or motor related aspects of behavior are readily observable and measurable when compared with other aspects. So, the quantification aspect of other functions are challenging. So, hence design of experiments related to other functions are also challenging, yet they are an important part of functions that must be studied. So, essentially basal ganglia participates in multiple functions including cognitive, associative, executive, limbic, emotional, etc. However, in this course, we will only focus on motor functions of the basal ganglia. And so, in this class alone, I will introduce what are the other circuitry and what are the other functions, but in future classes, we will restrict our attention to the motor aspects of basal ganglia function. In general, the loops within the basal ganglia or loops involving the basal ganglia are the following: cortico basal ganglia, thalamocortical loops. So, basically the input starts from the cortex, goes to striatum, goes to GPI, or SNR, and from there to thalamus, and from there to the cortex. So, essentially the loop is cortico basal ganglia thalamocortical loops, and this manifests in four major loops. These are motor, or more specifically skeletomotor loop, oculomotor loop involving eye function, executive and associative loop, and emotional motivation or the limbic loop. And it turns out that each of this loop has dedicated a specified area within the basal ganglia. So, and their inputs are kept separated, their processing loops are kept separate, and their outputs are also kept separate. So, essentially what you are having is an architecture that is parallel in nature. So, that means different aspects of behavior are processed parallelly by the basal ganglia. So, essentially behavior is this complicated. So, essentially behavior is this combination of motor, emotional, associative, executive, perception, a whole number of different functions, right? And different aspects of these are processed, and different aspects of these are processed in different pathways within the basal ganglia. So, essentially the basal ganglia performs parallel processing of different aspects of behavior. In other words, there is a dedicated motor loop, there is a dedicated oculomotor loop, and there is a dedicated limbic loop, and there is a dedicated executive loop. So, for a given function, these four can and will act in parallel simultaneously for a given behavior. So, regarding the motor loop, where does this originate? Well, from the motor areas of the cortex, primarily the M1, which is the primary motor cortex, and the supplementary motor area, the cingulate motor area, and the premotor area. Within the striatum, much of these outputs are to putamen. Usually many of these outputs from the cortical loops are to the putamen, and from there to pallidum and or substantia nigra pars reticulata, and from there to the thalamus and specific nuclei of the thalamus. This is ventrolateral nucleus and ventral anterior nucleus. Note, within the ventrolateral nucleus there is this particular part called pars oralis, and also the medial part of the ventrolateral nucleus, and ventral anterior nucleus, the parvocellular part. Right? We will discuss the motor loop in relatively great detail in future classes. Right? So, the inputs are essentially M1 supplementary motor area, premotor area, and cingulate motor area. The outputs are ventrolateral and ventral anterior nucleus of the thalamus. The oculomotor loop, the inputs are cortical inputs are from frontal eye field and the supplementary eye field, right, in the frontal cortex, right. The outputs are through the thalamus, but different areas in the thalamus. Earlier we said it is VAVL thalamus, right. So, here we said VLO and VLM thalamus. Here it is actually mediodorsal nucleus of the thalamus and ventrolateral nucleus of the thalamus. This is an area that is shared with the motor loop, which is basically the ventral anterior nucleus of the thalamus in the parvocellular part, right, that one. That is shared with the skeletomotor area. So, the ventral anterior nucleus is present both in the oculomotor loop and in the skeletomotor loop. It is not necessary for you to remember all this terminology, which particular nucleus of the thalamus is responsible, but it is important for you to remember that different nuclei act as output nuclei from the thalamus. Basically, the reason why this is important is because there is segregation. It is important to understand the concept of segregated inputs are kept segregated in the processing loops, and the outputs are also segregated. So, this is the important concept to grasp. It is probably not important to remember every little detail and memorize the names of this. Of course, if you are interested, you can always try read about this and get more information. So, what is the oculomotor loop responsible for? So, there are two pathways, the nigrotectal pathway and the nigrocollicular pathway. So, here when we say nigrotectal and the nigrocollicular pathway, we are talking about substantia nigra pars reticulata, not substantia nigra pars compacta. Substantia nigra pars compacta sends dopaminergic inputs to the striatum, whereas substantia nigra pars reticulata sends outputs to the areas that control eye movements, right. So, the nigrotectal pathway, voluntary circuits initiated in the frontal eye field. So, essentially this may be, there is speculation that this may be involved in events associated with movements such as memory guided circuits, right. Then the other pathway is nigrocollicular pathway. Function is not similar to that of motor circuit. So, in this case what happens is that inhibition of basal ganglia in oculomotor loop results in involuntary circuit. So, somewhat different from the motor function, right. Inhibition of corresponding areas in the motor this actually do not cause excessive movement. So, slight difference in function, but not complete difference, right. So, this is the oculomotor loop. The executive loop, right, the origin of this loop is in the so called dorsolateral prefrontal cortex and lateral orbitofrontal cortex. These two areas are now gaining. So, the origins of the associative and executive loops are the so called dorsolateral prefrontal cortex and the lateral orbitofrontal cortex. These two areas are gaining tremendous attention and traction these days owing to our interest in studying reward related behavior, in studying motivation related behavior, in studying decision making, executive decision making, etcetera. So, neuroeconomics, neuromarketing kind of studies involve observation of activity in DLPFC and LOFC in a great manner, but here we restrict our attention to the basal ganglia related function, right. So, from the cortex the inputs come from DLPFC and LOFC, essentially dorsolateral prefrontal cortex and lateral orbitofrontal cortex, and the outputs are through the VL caudal part of the rostral division. So, in the ventrolateral thalamus, but a different area in the ventrolateral thalamus when compared with the motor loop, and the VN nucleus parvocellular part and the ventral anterior nucleus, the medial part and the mediodorsal nucleus, the more lateral part of this, all right. So, in other words, again it is not necessary for you to remember every little detail, but it is necessary for you to remember that these areas are different from the motor areas. So, this segregation is maintained throughout the basal ganglia loops, all right. And what are the functions? Well, essentially this is responsible for organizing or coordinating response to relatively complex problems, right, such as using verbal skills or in solving of problems. The other one, the lateral orbitofrontal circuit, you know, is believed to be responsible for what is considered socially appropriate behavior. So, there are disorders of basal ganglia where sometimes some people manifest or show symptoms where they lack an ability to appropriately behave in the society. So, they do not, so normal person would not pick up somebody else's pen from a table, for example, right. So, there is an inhibition to do something that is socially unacceptable, and this inhibition is tonically caused due to the, is probably due to the tonic inhibition coming out of the basal ganglia, right. So, basically the basal ganglia output is essentially tonically inhibiting. So, this is what causes the social, so this is what causes the social inhibition that we have. So, for example, if there is a pen of someone else in a table and that someone else is sitting right in front of me, I would not pick up the pen and put it in my pocket if I am a normal person, right. People with this disorder, for example, would not really have that inhibition. So, they will pick up somebody else's pen, they will do things that are considered inappropriate in a social occasion, right. So, again giving us insight about the important role of basal ganglia in behavior. So, then the limbic loop. From the frontal cortex, the inputs come from the medio orbitofrontal cortex, also from the anterior cingulate area, right. In the thalamus, the outputs go from the the parvocellular part, so this is an area that seems to participate practically in all the functions, right. VA parvocellular part is an area that practically participates in all the functions, right. And the medial part and the mediodorsal part of the thalamus. Note, importantly, limbic loop receives input of course from amygdala, hippocampus, entorhinal cortices. Obviously, limbic loop receives inputs from the emotional brain, right. So, the emotional brain is the amygdala, right. So, a lot of function related to emotions is performed by the so called emotional brain, right. There is a book on this topic, those who are interested can read this book, you could Google for this, the emotional brain, right. So, obviously, basal ganglia also receives inputs from the emotional part, the emotional brain. Once again, the important function of the limbic loop is relatively poorly understood. So, what exactly is the contribution of basal ganglia to emotions is relatively poorly understood when compared with say the motor loop, right. So, for example, the ACA or the anterior cingulate area, right, is responsible for motivation related behavior. So, this acts via multiple inputs including ventral tegmental area and substantia nigra reticulata. Again, it may reinforce different stimuli to multiple areas of basal ganglia and cortex. So, again, very little understanding of the limbic loop, but whatever is available is presented here. The loops involving basal ganglia are essentially cortico, basal ganglia, thalamocortical loops, and there are four functional areas, motor or skeletomotor areas, oculomotor areas, executive or association, and limbic or emotional. An important point to note is that regardless of which part of the cortex the input to the basal ganglia comes from, the output of the basal ganglia always goes to the frontal cortex. Important to note that the basal ganglia or the striatum receives inputs from almost the entire cortex except the primary visual and primary auditory cortex. But the basal ganglia output is almost always restricted to the frontal areas in the cortex, right. So, also note if there is extensive connection within the cortex, so more extensive the cortico-cortical networks, right. If the cortico-cortical network is more extensive between two areas of the cortex, in other words, there is a lot of information sharing between one area of the cortex and another area of the cortex, and if these two areas of the cortex project to the basal ganglia, their projections overlap. If there is less projection from one area of the cortex to another area of the cortex and these two areas project to the striatum, then these two areas do not overlap or overlap less in the striatum, okay. So, with this we come to the end of this lecture, we will continue our discussion in future classes. So, thank you very much.